Lord, even when we can't see what you're doing, we know that you are doing something. And so, God, we thank you for it. Lord, we lift up your name. We cry out, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we can cry out, Hosanna. Lord, help us. Hosanna in the highest. God, we praise your name this evening. What an honor and a privilege it is to step into your throne room, Lord God, and cry out before you and call you Father, call you Abba. Lord, we love you this evening. We turn our gaze on you, Lord. Father, we say, be exalted, be high and lifted up. For you said, when you are lifted up, you will draw all to you. And so, God, this evening, we lift you up as a congregation, God. For this midweek service, we lift up your holy name. Father, you are worthy to be praised. We join in with the heavenly host crying out, hallelujah, hallelujah to your name, O God. Be exalted. Be magnified, O majestic one. We thank you, Lord, that we can call on your name knowing that you are here with us. We can take each and every step knowing that you are guiding and leading, for you promised to be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. So we say thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us through this day. You brought us through this week. In this midweek, Lord God, you are bringing us through and you'll bring us through to the end. And God, we are grateful for your love, for your kindness, for your gentleness toward us, Father. We thank you, Lord, that you are our deliverer. You are our strength. God, you are our buckler and the horn of our salvation. You are our high tower, Lord God. Father, we thank you, God, that we can not doubt. We don't have to fear. You said you have not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. And so whatever might be coming against us or whatever we've just walked through, it's because you are Lord in our lives. And we thank you, Lord. You are God, and you are seeing us through every trial, every tribulation, every challenge. You are seeing us through every happy time, every exciting and amazing time. You are there. Because you said you would be our God and we would be your people. Because you have made your home on the inside of our hearts. Lord, I thank you that the word tells us that once we weren't a people, but now we are a people because of you. And we are grateful, God. We are grateful for the testimony of calling you Abba. Thank you for being our Redeemer, for being the Savior, for being the lover of our souls, oh God. Lord, you are amazing. Lord, tonight is all about you, God. Father, we thank you. We just want to say thank you. Thank you, Lord. I encourage you to think of that thing that you are thankful for. What did God do in your life? What has he done? What is he doing? And think about what he will do. These things we are thankful for and grateful for, an opportunity to open our mouths. Some people didn't get a chance to do that this morning, but we get a chance all day. And so, God, we are grateful, God. We thank you for being a strong tower in which you are who we can run into, the righteous can run into and be safe. And that's so amazing, God. You thought of everything. You've given us all of the resources from your word, which is living and active, to intercession, to prayer, which causes us to come before your throne. Father, we are grateful. God, you've given us a community of people to do community with, to do life with, and we are grateful, God. So we say, have your way in this service tonight, God. Have your way. Lord, we surrender and yield to you and your way, God. We don't want to overstep what we're doing. We don't want to be in front of you. We want to be right beside you, God. We thank you that you are our front and our rear guard, and we don't have to be fearful about going out. We don't have to be fearful about coming in because you are always with us, God. We thank you for your angels who go and protect us. Who you send out to protect us, who go before us, the ministering angels who minister before we even hit the street, God, we thank you for it. Father, you are wonderful. You are good. And we exalt your name. Be exalted, O Most High God. Thank you, Lord. What a privilege and an honor it is to come and worship at your footstool once again. Lord, we magnify you. You are great. You are mighty. You are wonderful. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you. And we say that we love you from the bottom of our hearts, oh God, with every fiber in our being, because it is in you that we live, move, and have our being. Lord, it's not in our own strength. It's not in our own ingenuities. It's not in our own thoughts, but it's in you, God. Hallelujah, Lord. Be exalted, Lord. Father, with every thought that we think in this moment, Lord, may it be pleasing in your sight. May our heart posture be one of surrender to you. Father, we thank you for the ability to call on your name. I can't imagine what it would be like to not be able to call on you. What it would be like to not be able to pray to you, oh God. So thank you, Holy Spirit, for the revelation of God and who he is, Yahweh. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we worship you and we magnify you. Father, tonight as we cover this service, Lord, would you be pleased? Lord, would you be pleased with our prayers as we start out? And Lord, then we pray. We want to pray over the worship team, Lord God, the band, as they prepare to lead us in worship. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for the praise that they've done in their homes before they even came out here, Lord God, for the worship they did in their car before they even arrived at this building, Lord. Father, we thank you that you would be pleased with each and every person, Lord God, singing unto you. And Father, we pray over the baptisms tonight, Lord God. We pray over each and every candidate tonight, Lord, that they are doing a new thing tonight, the outworking of the decision that they've already made. Lord, would you have this experience be unlike any other for them, Lord God, that as they go down into the waters and come up, they would hear your voice, Lord God, that they would feel your presence and know that you are God. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for the ministry of the word that will go forth and through Pastor Jermaine, God. We pray, Lord, that as he speaks, that the words will be applicable to us, Lord God, that we will be able to take it and say, I can use this in this area, in that area, because it comes straight from your heart, Lord God, for us. And so, Lord, I thank you for preparing the people and making their hearts and minds open to hear what is being preached, what is being ministered, what is being taught, oh God. Father, we ask that if there's anything that is ill with Pastor Jermaine, that you would heal his body, Lord, touch him in this moment. Father, that nothing would hinder the ministry of the word, God. We thank you that you are good, whether it's a stomach ache or a backache, God, whatever it might be. We thank you for healing your son, God, in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you for the AV team. We thank you for the Grace Kids team, Lord God, hospitality, the ushers, God, the staff. We thank you for all those who have come to serve in this service, Lord God. Lord, we lift them up before you, each and every one. You know each of them by name, oh God. And we thank you, Lord, that you are doing it. For this is all for the glory and honor of you. God, we worship you in the beauty of your holiness tonight, oh God. Be exalted, Majesty. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Worship the God of Israel, the God of Isaac, Jacob, Abraham, and the God of say your name. So the God of Christine, yes. Say your name, because he is your father. He is your God. Let's worship him in your own way, because he wants to hear your voice. He created you specifically for worship and the extension of his kingdom. So, God, we exalt your name. Lord, I thank you that we can call on you, oh, Father, the mighty one. You are the God that created rivers in the desert. You are the God that caused Israel to have food all that time they were there. You are Lord in our lives. Even now, you cause us to have everything that we need, because you are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. You are Jehovah Rophe, our healer. You are El Shaddai. Oh, God, you are Jehovah Nissi, the banner over us. God, we worship you. We worship your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. He is amazing, y'all. God loves us so much. He cares for us so much. And sometimes we can miss that. And even in the little things that he does, We can miss it, but if we focus in on him on a daily basis, we can't help but give him the glory. We can't help but give him the honor that's due unto him. And so every time you get an opportunity, just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for waking me up. Thank you for bringing me to my job, to and from my job, and wherever else I need to go. Thank you, Lord, for being a provider. He is our rock in which we stand on, a firm foundation. When the winds blow, we won't be pushed over. We won't fall because he is who we stand on. Our firm foundation. God, we say that with all that we are, we will bless you. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, your name will always be praised, oh God. Father, would you touch this service like you always do? We're not asking for anything different. We want to feel your presence, oh God. We relinquish this service over to you from the beginning to the end of it, Lord God. We know that as we prepare to worship, God, we're asking that you would inhabit the praises of your people, oh God. God, that as we praise you with our hearts, as we worship you with our hands and in the dance, God, it is because you are so good and so lovely and so kind. God, we exalt your name. We exalt your name. Hallelujah. Say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. God, we worship you. We magnify your name. So as we get ready to worship, if you're not standing, jump up on your feet and let's get ready to praise our God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, can we give the Lord a clap of praise tonight? Hallelujah. Come on, can we begin to fill this room with praise? Hallelujah. The scripture tells us, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. For his mercy endures forever, for his love endures forever. Can we thank the Lord right here, family? Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on, if you have breath in your body tonight, can you thank him for that? Come on, if you've experienced his mercy today, can you thank him for that? If you've experienced his goodness, can you thank him for that? Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. God, we're grateful. God, we're thankful. You're full of grace. You're full of mercy. You are faithful, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. We give thanks to you, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord, all my soul, and all that is within me will bless his name. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you that you are faithful through every generation and every season, Lord. That in a world where systems may fail us, Lord, you never fail us. Where people may fail us, you never fail us, God. And we sing of your faithfulness tonight. yields to mine. All of my shout of praise in the room to the great and mighty God. Come on, to the one who is worthy of this praise, to the one who is worthy of this worship. Hallelujah, Lord. We bless you, God. What a faithful God you are. Hallelujah. Oh. Hallelujah, Lord. That you never fail us, Lord, and you never will. We sing of your faithfulness tonight. Hallelujah. Come on, clap your hands like this. Yeah.
He won't fail. He won't leave you. No, he won't fail. One more time. He won't fail. So he won't leave you. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, and no seed begging for bread. Always, and you never fail, and you never will. He won't fail. He won't leave you. No, he won't fail.
I don't know where you find yourself this evening. I don't know what season you may be in, but I feel like this is a reminder for someone in the room. You may have felt like the Lord has left your side and that he doesn't see where you are or what you're going through. But our God is closer than your very next breath. He is constant, he is faithful, and he is with you. So we're going to sing this chorus one more time, but I really want us to allow the revelation of these words to encourage our souls on this evening. Let's sing it together. He won't fail.
He won't fail. He won't fail.
Sing, he won't leave me. Make it personal.
He won't leave me. No, he won't fail. He won't fail.
He won't fail.
Sing, he won't fail.
He won't fail.
Sing, he won't leave me.
He won't leave.
No, he won't fail.
No, he won't.
Last time.
Sing, he won't fail.
Mighty God you are. What a holy God you are. What a faithful God you are. Thank you, Lord. We sing of your goodness tonight. We sing of your might. We sing glory to the King of Kings. We give honor to the Lord of Lords. Every hallelujah is yours.
Every gesture of your hand, waves of fear collapse at your command. And I know tomorrow, when the pressure rushes in, you'll be there to rescue me again. What a mighty God you are.
135 verses 1 through 3, it says, hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise him, you servants of the Lord, who are standing in the house of the Lord, in the courtyards of the house of our God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, because He is good. You know, hallelujah is an exclamation of worship. It's a call to praise the name of God. It's not just something we just say with passion. And I think that recently I have realized that sometimes I will just say hallelujah. Like, I'll see gas for $3 and I'll be like, hallelujah. Or someone will pay for my coffee and I'll say hallelujah. But I can tell you that when I had said it just almost carelessly, there's not an ounce of worship in it. And I've been so convicted about that recently, that when we say the word hallelujah, it is of worship. We are saying, God, I'm worshiping you. I'm taking a moment to say, praise your name. Holy is your name. Glory, glory, and another hallelujah. Like, think about that. 1,000 hallelujahs. What are the hallelujahs in your life? Can we go back into that? And that bridge, 1,000 hallelujahs. Think about those moments in your life where you are saying hallelujah, maybe right now. And if you don't have one, let me tell you, God is good, and so there's one. Okay? Hallelujah!
Oh Lord my God, how great you are, sing honor, honor, and power, and another hallelujah.
One who heals us, who comforts us, who makes a way when we've completely destroyed the path in front of us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Lord, we give this night to you. We say, have your way. You are a good, good Father, and we say hallelujah. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, welcome to Midweek. My name is HB. It's nice to see you all here. If you're in the room, you can go ahead and have a seat. Well, this is our Midweek service where we get to gather together to encounter the Lord in a fresh new way. We hope for you and that you leave different, that you leave transformed, that you leave having met someone new, that you leave feeling loved by us, but most importantly by God. So welcome, welcome, welcome. If you are new here, you can scan the QR code behind me or text GCC to 82155. We'd love to get to know you. Well, it is time for tithes and offering. Amen. We get excited because we love to be able to give to a really good God. It was like last year. I heard a song, and if I was a singer, I would sing it for you, but I'm not going to do that. Instead, you'll just hear my voice. But the lyrics, the end of the chorus, it says, if you reap what you sow, what kind of garden would you grow? If you reap what you sow, what kind of garden would you grow? And it immediately reminded me of in Galatians, where Paul says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. So Paul here is reminding the church of, like, God's principle of sowing and reaping, that when we give, it's not just, we're not just throwing money away, but we're sowing into something, and then we will reap it. And so, you know, this moment is, we're talking about finances and giving, yes. But I think even just to take it a little further, like, what is the garden that you wish to have one day? And I'm not talking about, like, plants or vegetables, but, like, do you want your life to look like patience or generosity or kindness? And in this moment, I know that as we are giving, I would pray that we can all sow some obedience of what God's asking us to give. So maybe it's generosity, because we know that God is a faithful God, and what we sow, we will reap. And so maybe tomorrow on your commute to work, you'll ask yourself that question too, of just like, hey, what am I sowing? What am I sowing? And because that's what I'm ultimately going to reap. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this time. God, I thank you for all of those who are sowing into your kingdom tonight, sowing into what you're doing in this church. God, would, as there's the sowing happens, God, I just pray that the reaping will be so beautiful, not just in our own eyes, but God, in your kingdom. So Lord, do what only you can do. Multiply this offering, we pray. It's in your name we pray, amen. All right, well, before we get into the word tonight, we have baptisms. We have a few folks getting baptized. Let's go. I see our Grace Youth crew in the house. Woo! Let's go. So, yeah, we've got three folks who are going to be getting baptized, and they have publicly declared that Jesus is Lord of their life, the center of their world. And so as they enter into the waters of baptisms, they are identifying with Christ's death and burial. And as they are raised up out of the waters there, it symbolizes them being raised to life, just as in Jesus's resurrection. So before they get baptized, Deanna is actually going to give them a prophetic word. So she's been praying for these folks, believing that God's going to speak something encouraging and uplifting that aligns with Scripture over their life. And so this is a really cool moment. So I encourage you all to lean in, stand with them, and believe these things over their lives.
Hi, Allie. It's a big day for you, huh? Allie, as I was praying for you, I felt like God gave me a scripture. Colossians 3:12. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Allie, you've been a down-to-earth person, not necessarily because you were naturally born that way, but life has kind of drained out the fairy tale from you. And you just kind of stopped looking for the fairy tale. You just kind of wanted the real thing. And then God surprised you with an alley-shaped fairy tale. And he came in, and it's like, God, is this too good to be true? No, it's not. It's not too good to be true. In fact, it's just going to keep getting better and better with him. And you know it's not about circumstances, which he's also in control of, but it's about his love for you and how he considers you to be so precious. Allie, you've been given a real precious gift, and this is the gift of kindness. You've experienced his kindness in remarkable ways. He came in and he gifted you through his kindness with his son. And this is something that you are not a person that's going to take this for granted. You know that you know that you know what you've experienced. And it has left a mark inside of you so deep and eternal. No one can steal that from you, Allie. Like, literally no one can steal that from you. And he wants you to lean into that with perfect confidence. that no matter what comes to you, no matter what words are spoken, maybe some people who haven't fully understood what's happened to you, whatever words they're speaking, nothing can steal what he has done in your life and what he's going to continue to do through your life. And what he's done is pouring out kindness. It's like an anointing. And scripture says that the anointing breaks the yoke. So it's breaking the yoke in your life, yes. Any entanglements that you've had, just any struggles of where you felt imprisoned, he's healing you and he's freeing you, and that is his promise for you. But it doesn't stay there, because guess what? As soon as you get your yoke broken, as your yoke is breaking, you're going to come out one. You are fierce. You are fierce, Allie, and he is going to use this kindness of God, which, by the way, is a weapon. It's some serious business, because it leads us to repentance. His kindness is what draws us to him, and his kindness is the thing that sets people free. And he has anointed you with that in spades. And so he's just saying, press in, Allie, press in. Press in, it's just going to get better. And you are going to see the same joy you're feeling. You're going to see it spread like wildfire around you. Father, we thank you for Allie. We thank you, Father God, for this precious, beautiful woman that you have called, that you have anointed, that you have filled with your kindness. And it's a strength and it's anointing that will break the yoke in people's lives so they can be set free to experience the joy and the majesty and the glory of your Son, Jesus Christ, who sets us free. So, Father, I pray for your protection over Allie's life. And I pray that she continues to experience in ever greater measure the glory of your goodness and kindness in her life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and in that name, Jesus Christ.
Brian. So I have a scripture for you. I'll read it and then I'll explain it. Psalm 2, 4 through 6. It says, he who sits in the heaven laughs. The Lord holds them, meaning those who set themselves against the Lord, in derision. Then he will speak to them, saying, as for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. Brian, you have set your king on your holy hill. You have proclaimed Jesus as the Lord of your life. And things have shifted for you. Brian, you've always been one. You went through life, and to cope, you would laugh. You would find that thing that would make you laugh. You would just dig in and find the angle that you could see to just, well, it was laugh or cry. And so you could laugh, you could find the humor in things. But there have been some moments where there was just no humor. And those have been the places that have really brought you to your knees before the Lord and to him in complete surrender. And the Lord is coming to you now, and he wants to reposition you so that you understand that with him on the throne of your life, you're going to be able to sit in heavenly places, as scripture says, and see from his perspective. So now you really can laugh, but from a place of security and from joy. Because you see that God reigns. He's over everything. You know, Brian, you carry a lot of concerns. You carry a lot of people in your heart. You've got a real pastor's heart. You carry a whole lot of people in your heart. And he also wants you to be able to recognize himself, him, God, sitting on the throne over their lives. And I saw very clearly as I prayed for you, all those people that you're carrying literally sitting in the palm of his hand. And he's breathing his life on them. And he wants you to have that picture as he looks down with so much love. You think you love them. He loves them even more. And they are well cared for and protected in his hands. So as you continue to intercede, you're going to start laughing as you pray. But you're going to laugh with confidence and you're going to laugh with joy because you know that God has great plans for all those that you're interceding for. He's got great plans for every situation. And this psalm goes on to say, ask of me and I will give you the nations, for they are your heritage. Brian, there's more in you, and the nations are inside of you. There's an intercessory call, and there's more than just an intercessory call. And he's going to start sending you to different places. And you're going to start claiming those places because you are asking the Lord for the nations. As you put him as king on your hill, the hill of your life, he's going to grant you the fruit of the nations as your heritage. As the heritage you have now in Jesus Christ. So, Father, we thank you for Brian. We thank you, God, that you have shifted and are shifting his perspective to recognize and see your glory, your authority, your majesty, Lord Jesus, and just the joy of knowing that you are Lord over all, that you carry every single person that's in his heart in the palm of your hand. And you don't just carry people, but you carry nations in the palm of your hand. And we thank you, God, that you're going to be working and moving through Brian, Lord Jesus, to see nations and lives transformed for your glory, Jesus. We love you and we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and in that name, Jesus Christ.
That's awesome. Edward, hi. Edward, awesome. All right, as I was praying for you, I felt like the Lord gave me this scripture. Titus 2, 11 through 14. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. Edward, God really, really deeply, deeply likes you, and he deeply loves you. And you felt almost like you've been in a season, and I'm going to have to look it up because I had to look it up earlier. It's like you're that rope caught in a ratchet strap. You know, those moving instruments, and it pulls the rope in and tightens and tightens and tightens. And it's like you're being pulled in tighter and tighter and tighter. And you've kind of been wondering, what's going on, Lord? Have I done something wrong? What is it? You haven't done anything wrong, Edward. He's pulling you tighter, closer to himself for intimacy, for training. Because what he's aware of is all of the incredible giftings and callings that he's invested and planted and put inside of you. He's setting you apart, Edward. You are called to be set apart for him, for his purposes. It's a holy calling, and one not to mess around with, and one to realize that when he disciplines us, he loves us. It's because he loves you, Edward, that he's tightening this ratchet and pulling you closer and closer to himself. He's put so much inside of you, and one thing that he wants to begin to transform in you is how you see yourself. There's going to be a relaxing that comes when you recognize how beloved you are. The Apostle John called himself the beloved. It's not because of pride, it's because he knew who he was in Jesus. And he knew that he was Jesus' beloved. That's the kind of intimacy that he's calling you into. And there's a relaxation that comes when you can lay your head upon his chest and be so super close to that him, so that even when he's training, disciplining, preparing, you can still lay your head on his chest and know that it's all out of love. He's calling you to great things for his kingdom. It says in the scripture there's a zeal and a passion for his works. And he's going to start giving you visions and dreams. You're going to start seeing yourself in dreams ministering, praying for people, seeing they're going to get healed. You're going to start seeing things you never thought you'd see, dreaming of the things that God is dreaming for your life. So, Father, we thank you for Edward. We thank you for this call in his life. We thank you, Jesus, that he's in this season of being brought closer into intimacy with you. We thank you, Lord, that you discipline those you love. You train those you love. And you love him dearly, Father God. We thank you that he's called to have an intimacy like John the Baptist, to lay his head on your chest and to know you, to know your love, and to have zeal for your works, the works of your kingdom. Father, we bless him now in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Edward, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In that name, Jesus Christ. Come on, come on. Are we on? Can you hear me? You can? Oh, awesome. Can we get excited about the baptisms today? I feel like we should be a little bit more excited that Jesus proclaiming himself as a resurrection and the life is not a past tense type of name. It is a present tense, that he is still the resurrection and the life, that he's still calling people from death to life, from darkness to light. He's bringing people into his kingdom. I'm so excited for these people that gave their life to Jesus, proclaiming it now for everyone here. Can we just pray for them real quick? Father, we thank you so much that you are still raising people to life, that you are still in the business of saving souls, that you are still in the business of finding the lost. And I thank you for these men and women who have made a decision to follow you, who've made a decision to give their life to you and to live it and to live it out loud. And so I thank you, God, that you're going to bless their life. And I pray for an overwhelming filling of your spirit in their life. Fill them afresh as they go out and follow you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Well, good evening.
All right, I'm going to need y'all to get a little bit more excited about that. I know it's springtime, doesn't feel like springtime, but here we are. We're in April already, but welcome to midweek. I'm so excited to be here. If you guys don't know who I am, my name is Jermaine. I am associate pastor at Grace Covenant Church Sterling currently, and in September of this year, 2024, I will be the lead pastor of a church plant in Chantilly Town. Can we get excited about that? We got any Chantilly Town folks in the house tonight? We're about to do some stuff. I'm excited. Here we go. I'm excited to share God's word with you tonight. Let's go ahead and hop right into it. We're going to be in 1 Samuel chapter 22. If you wouldn't mind, please stand in reverence to the reading of God's word. Got my big Bible here today. It means we got a big word for God to speak. It says this, the first two verses. It says, David left Gath and escaped to the cave of Adullam. When his brothers and his father's household heard about it, they went down to him there. All those who were in distress or in debt or discontented gathered around him, and he became their commander. About 400 men were with him. Today I'm going to speak from a topic called Caves to Castles. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for you, for your presence here tonight, for what you've already prepared to do in the hearts of everyone here, including myself. So God, we make ourselves available tonight for you to do what you have come here to do. And so, Father, I ask you in this place to help me decrease and you increase. God, do a work in me as well as the people in this house. Help us to hear from you well and to leave this place changed and transformed by your Holy Spirit. We invite you here now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Caves to castles. God takes David from the cave to the castle, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight. And you may be wondering what a castle is, and I just want to describe that very, very briefly. A castle is what I will describe as a place of promise. It's the place where you actually possess the promise. It's a place of your purpose. It's a place of your destiny. It's a place of your calling. It's a place of hope. It's a place of faith. It's a place where God has done something in your life and he has changed you. And I believe for a fact that everybody here under the sound of my voice is called to a castle. That everyone here has a destiny, has a call, has a purpose. That God wants to do something in your life that's bigger and greater than you could ever think, than you could ever imagine that he could do in your life. You are called to castles. But what I also believe is that as we look through the Bible and as we look through David's life, that before God actually allows us to enter into the castle, God takes us through caves, takes us to places of preparation, takes us through places of pain, takes us through places of maybe disappointment, takes us through places where God has to prepare our hearts for the place that he's called us to, and these are called caves. Caves to castles. And I believe God here in this passage gives us really three caves that I believe that God takes us through. Takes us through a cave, the cave of purpose, which I'll talk about tonight. Takes us through the cave for people, and the cave of preference. Here we have David in this story. David's in a cave, a literal cave. And quick recap, let me tell you a little bit about David's story. Most of you know what is going on in David's life, but David is just this really cool kid doing his own thing, just a shepherd boy, playing his instruments and just having a good time, taking care of sheep. I mean, he's a good-looking lad, but, you know, he's just having a good time. He didn't ask God for kingdoms. He didn't ask God to anoint him to do anything. He's just minding his own business, and God sees fit somehow to anoint him to be king. And Saul messes up, and God anoints him to be king, and then now David begins to walk in his calling, and David finds himself in the service of King Saul after he's defeated Goliath, and he's helping to soothe Saul's insecurities, and he's playing instruments. But then all of a sudden, what you see in Scripture is that David, as he begins to get exalted, begins to elevate, we see something weird happen. We see people begin to favor David over Saul. And what we see is women, I'm not blaming these women here, but they begin singing this song about David. And it's one thing to sing a song about a person, but it's another thing to sing a song about a person that elevates him, but then you put down another person like it's a diss track to Saul. David slays 10,000. Saul, 1,000. Who? What? Why? Why would they do that? And it creates this insecurity in Saul. Insecurity he already had, but it just begins to heighten his insecurity. And now Saul wants to kill David. And so now David, who didn't really ask for this, but is anointed for this, has to now run for his life. Now David, this is where we find David in this passage. He has ran from Saul. He's escaped to Gath, and now he has to leave Gath, and he finds himself escaping to a cave, and he ends up making decisions to land here. Some of these decisions that he has made, or most of them, he makes without really consult of God, and he's just making it, trying to just save his own life, but he finds himself in a cave. It's not a mansion. It's not the Marriott. But it's the meeting place for him and God. And how many of you know that's the best place to be? Like after all the running and after all the escaping and after all the escaping and all the running, David lands exactly in the place that God wants him to be. Some of us get really excited about that. And the question is, why would God want to meet David in the cave? Why would God anoint him king but then have David go through the things that he's going through right now? And he lands in this place that he probably doesn't want to be, but could it be that God had anointed him to rule, but knew that David wasn't ready to rule? Could it be that God knew that David was a man that was after his own heart, but God himself was after David's heart? And listen, the cave becomes more than just a place for David to hide, more than just a place for him to run away from his problems and not face his problems. It's more than just a place to escape or a place to wither away and die. Is actually a place of refuge. And a place of refuge is a place where God is. It's a place of God's design. It is a necessary place. The place where he lands is the place between the promise of becoming king and then the possession of becoming king. It's the land in between. This is the cave that David finds himself in. And it's where God is beginning to work on David to work out his character before David can actually walk into his calling. Now, this is not atypical of God to be willing to take someone through caves. Again, I'll call this the cave of purpose. This is not atypical of God. God is willing and always willing to take someone through a cave. And I'll give you an acronym for cave that I have. It's a place where your calling is approved and your virtue is enriched. It's a place where God begins to align your assignment as he begins to work on your character to get you ready for the place that God has called you to go. The place where calling is approved and virtue is enriched. A place where he prepares you for your purpose. In the Bible, we see different types of caves. They're not always just going to be a cave. We see different types of caves. We see Abram being sent into a cave of the unknown, not knowing exactly what God is going to do in his life, but knowing that God is sending him somewhere. We see the cave of the wilderness as God begins to work on the hearts of his people, the Israelites. He's trying to get the slavery out of his freed people so that when they possess the land that God has called them to possess, that they would actually be a conduit of blessing that he had desired for them to be. We see caves of prison. We see caves of prison like Joshua, like God was doing something Joseph. God was doing something in Joseph. In the prison, preparing him for the place that he was going to elevate him to. God has zero problems with saving someone from themselves through the process we call sanctification, to take a person through the cave to make them more like Christ before he actually puts them in a castle to complete the work he's called them to do. Now, many of us are probably in caves or been in caves right now. Different types of caves. Caves, dead-end jobs. But really, it's more like a job that you've hit a ceiling. And you're waiting for promotion. And promotion isn't coming. Maybe you're waiting for someone to snuggle up with in marriage. Hear me what I'm saying. We're in church, family. Listen, maybe you got someone to snuggle up with in marriage, but you guys aren't snuggling up like you used to anymore. You're in marital difficulty. Maybe you're battling some physical issue, some physical ailment that has creating some limitation in your life. Maybe you're in an unknown space and you're looking and you're lacking clarity that you need to move forward. Maybe you're in a place where you just kind of want to be seen and you want to be heard, but you're not being seen and you're not being heard. And maybe you feel like it's actually being done intentionally and you're wrongfully being put in a corner. Listen, am I being too real right now?
No.
Right? Just enough? I feel like I'm being too real. Like this is my life. This is a little transparency that I have for you guys here. Yeah, just enough for the city. Some of these things that I've been through, some of these things that I've worked through, some of these things that I've seen other people walk through. And you may find yourself in a place like this, in between promise and in between possession. But here is the truth that I come with you today. It's quite possible that God has allowed you to be in that place. And it's not a place to run from. It's actually a place of refuge, which is a place for you to run to. It's not a place for you to give up. It's not a place for you to walk out. It's not a place that's designed to take you out. It's a place where God is actually trying to press you. It's a place of pressing where he is actually designed to empower you to proceed into your purpose. It's the place that God has designed for you. And I'm saying, don't despise the place of God's design. Because if you despise it, family, you'll dismiss it. And if you dismiss it, then you will destroy what God is trying to develop inside of you. And this is the place, this is the type of place that you look back on a month from now, or a year from now, or 2 years from now, and you say, oh man, God has worked all things together for my good. Like there's something that has happened through this situation that God has made me better. Like I'm a better husband, I'm a better father, I'm a better wife, I'm a better mother, I'm a better human all around. Right? I'm stronger. I'm wiser. I'm more mature. I'm more emotionally healthy, more spiritually healthy. Why? Because God has done something through this situation that has made me better and made me more like him. I wish I had somebody here who had a story and a testimony that knew that God had done something in your life that's made you more like him and made you better. That's the cave of purpose. Mission accomplished. There's also this cave for people. And so what we find David here in this moment, David is in this cave and he's going through this character development type of situation and God is doing something in his life. And then his family shows up. How many know that's just like family? When you're just kind of going through something and you want to be left alone, they just like to invade your private space. That's my story. It's not something that I would actually like to have happen. And I'm not quite sure if David didn't desire this. I think historically, when we look back at this passage, I think we can see that David had a desire for his family to come and be with him. But the question is, what is this teaching us? What is this trying to reveal to us today? And I believe that God wants us to hear this, to know that your purpose and your calling and the associated pressing and character development is not just about you. It's not just a straight line between you and Jesus. It's more like a web, or more like I would call like a Venn diagram, where your life is a circle and your purpose is a circle, but it's actually connected to other circles and there's overlapping connections connecting you to not just yourself, but to those closest to you. And it's also connecting you to generations that are to follow you. And see, if you follow the timeline of events, David enters the cave before his family. So before David is in the cave with his family, David is in the cave for his family. And God allowed David to enter the cave, not just for him, but for those who would follow him. David had to find a place so that his family didn't have to try and find a place of refuge on their own. And here's also the reality of what's happening in the moment. The same person, the same enemy that's trying to take David out, that's trying to take his life out, is now the same enemy that's trying to take his family out. And so his family is having to leave Bethlehem to come down to where David is in the cave. They needed safety. They needed refuge. They needed help. They needed hope. And thank God that David already had a meeting place with God before his family came so that they could have a meeting place with God too. And see, what I'm saying is the same enemy that's chasing you, that's chasing you and the problems that are chasing you and this world that's chasing after you, it's the same ones that are chasing after the people in our life. And if you're a person, you got people. You got a mama and daddy, or you had a mama and a daddy like myself, and you got sisters and brothers and uncle and auntie and friends and foes, and there's an enemy that's chasing after you. They're chasing after your people too. And sometimes we find ourselves in a cave. It's not a party. It's not fun. It's not easy. But it's God's will, and God has designed us to go to it and then go through it so that those who are closest to us will actually follow us and don't have to go through the same thing. Listen, if you're a believing Christian in this place, this is the gospel. This is what we believe, that our King Jesus came down from heaven, stepped into the cave of this earth, lived a life that we couldn't live but should have, died the death that we deserve to die, lived a life that we couldn't live, died the death that we deserve to die, got up from the grave 3 days later, proving himself to be God so that those who will believe in him would believe in him and follow him and would have forgiveness of their sins and have eternal life. This is the gospel, that Jesus came down and did what we couldn't do and went through the hell that we don't have to go through so that now we can have life and live the life that he desires for us to have. He is the greater David. He is the greatest expression, really, of this passage. His mission on earth, the purpose of the cross, was not about him. It's about us who were to follow him. Well, family, this is my story. I could spend hours telling you all the juicy details of my life, but I don't have the time, but just hear me. I know that some of the trials that I've been through, some of the issues that I've walked through, some of the things that I've endured, some of the things that God has worked to prune in me, to mature me, to make me better, they have not just been about me. They have been about my two boys, Kingston and Levi, who God has given me to follow me so that they don't have to go through the same things that Daddy went through. Now, I know that they're going to have to go through some of the things of their own. They're going to have to fight some battles on their own. They're going to have to deal with those things. But I believe that some of the things that I've walked through, some of the curses that I've been able to break in our family line has made it just a little bit easier for my boys to be able to walk this thing out and to live this thing out. And they've seen Daddy pray. And they've seen Daddy cry. They've seen me lead and love and fight and just like lean in to God. They see me worship. And now they have a better cave that they can now launch out of into the purpose and call for their life. Family, don't leave your cave prematurely. Your household salvation and deliverance is dependent upon you in the cave. They need to see you in it. They need to see you walk through it so that they can follow you out of it. Listen to what I'm saying. Listen, there's a story in Acts chapter 16 where Paul and Silas are in prison. And they're in prison and they're praying. And it says it's about midnight. And as they're in prison and they're praying, their chains fall off and they are freed. But I believe that they were in the prison, in the cave, not just for themselves, but for the jailer that was in the place. And the jailer wakes up and realizes that the doors are open. And what does he say? Because he thinks that all of the men are gone. And because they're gone, he's in trouble. And he knows that his life is on the line. So he says, I'm going to take my own life, snuff my own life out. And Paul and Silas says, wait, don't do it, man. Can you imagine if they had left the cave? But they didn't leave the cave. And the jailer sees Paul and Silas, and they recount the story, and they tell him about Jesus, and he gives his life to Jesus. And not only that, he takes them to his home, and his entire household gets saved. They stayed in the cave, and the jailer didn't take himself out as well. And not only did he get saved, his whole family got saved. And the purpose for them being in the cave was not just for him, and the jailer not taking his life out was not just for him and for his family. And he became an integral part of planting the church in Philippi. It's not just about you, family. It's not just about you. Now, this is the best part of the story for me, that David finds himself in a cave, and he's running for his life, and God is working on his heart, and his family is there, and then God decides in verse 2 to send David some reinforcements. All those who were in distress or in debt or discontented, they gathered around him. Yeah. I first read it, I was like, God sent David the best of the best. No, he didn't. He sent him the elite. He sent him number one draft picks. No, that is not who God decided to send. He didn't send him LeBron James. He sent him the Washington Wizards roster, right? Did I say that? We got Wizards fan in the house? I'm sorry. They stink. Trash. Oh, sorry. My bad. But he sends David 400 of the most jacked up men available. And the Bible doesn't hold back as it describes them, right? They're men who are broken, they are dissatisfied, man, they're messy. And they're just looking for something, man. They're looking for some freedom, they're looking for some hope, they're looking for some purpose, right? And it's not that these men aren't qualified to some degree. They have some qualifications, they have some military training, but all the things that they had actually didn't give them any real prospects for a prosperous life or a future. And so they find themselves in their own caves. They find themselves in their own caves, caves of depression, caves of dissatisfaction, of disillusionment, of darkness and despair. But what I love about these men is that they didn't settle in their own caves. In those places where most people tend to settle in their pain, in their struggle, in their circumstances, these men made a decision not to allow these caves to be what determines where they go. So they didn't allow the caves that were killing them to keep them from going to the cave of the king. And this is how God works in our life sometimes, that he might allow a tough situation to develop in our life, but it's not meant to pull us away from him. It's actually meant to push us right into his presence. The gospel is littered with examples of this, where we find moments of breakthrough that were preceded by seasons of brokenness. Every single one of these occurrences that we see in the Bible where Jesus tends to heal somebody, they all have something very similar that is a similar thing that kind of makes this thing happen, and it's really called desperation. What we see is that these people are going through something, and they've been through something, and they're just kind of now tired of going through something. So what they do is, instead of staying in the place of their pain, staying in the place of their discomfort, they begin to push through crowds, push through people, push through their own pride, push through their discomfort, just so they can get close to the one person who can do something about it. And sometimes we go through things just like this so that God can get us to get close to him. It's like the woman with the issue of blood. For 12 years, she's struggling with this issue that has ostracized her from society. She can't connect with anyone. I mean, it is emotionally, physically, and spiritually damaging to her life. But she doesn't make a decision to stay in that place. When a moment where Jesus was close by, she goes, you know what? They don't want me here, but I'm going to push through my pride. I'm going to push through my insecurity. I'm going to push through my pain. I'm going to push through these people that are not allowing me to get to Jesus, because if I can just get close to him, if I can just touch him, man, God can do something. God can change me. God can change my life. And the question is, where does your brokenness lead you? Which cave will you choose? It's what we call the cave of preference. Which cave will you choose? David in this passage becomes the greatest example and illustration and application for this point. We get three of the greatest psalms that David ever wrote from this account in Scripture. Psalm 34, Psalm 57, Psalm 142. Words like, you know, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Where David says, taste and see that the Lord is good. That God is near to the brokenhearted. These are the words that David pens as he's going through this very account. And you can see that God, what God is doing in his life actually becomes what David does, is David begins to worship God. David turns his cave into his church. And you guys have to, we all have to kind of make a decision on what we will allow our circumstances to do for us. Will we allow our circumstance to become this place of bondage or our place of breakthrough? Will it be our place of fear or will it be our place of freedom? Will it be this place where we're in prison or will it be a place where we know that God has a purpose that he wants to accomplish in our life and it's God's will, not our own? Is it a place where I'm going to not worry? Is it going to be a place where I'm going to worship? You guys hear what I'm saying today? Because if it's a place where I'm going to worship, then I know that God's going to do something. It is Psalm 23, that like, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Why? Because I know that God has placed me here. And because God has placed me here in this place, I know that God is with me. And if God is with me, then I know that God is for me. And I know what God is for me, and I know that in this place, God is doing something to change me. That God is doing something to transform me. That God is trying to help me. That God is trying to free me. That God is trying to make me whole. That God is trying to make me better. That God is trying to make me stronger. That God is working in my life. That he's trying to bring me from the cave to the castle. What is your preferred cave? I tend to prefer the cave of the king. You know what I love about this passage as I come to a close? Is this, and it's why I believe this has been so impactful and transformative in my life, is because it reminds me about who God is. That God takes us from caves to castles. In this account, we see that this really does become the launching point for David. He really just begins to ascend from here. And there's some things he still has to walk through and go through. But now David is not alone. As we see now, as they mention David, it's now not just David, it's David and his men. As you read the story, that's what we see. David and his men. And when David is anointed king a few chapters later, as we read in Chronicles, these men are described a little differently. As they described them in 1 Samuel 22, they're messy. But as they described them later, they're mighty. I didn't like the response on this side. They were messy. And now they're mighty. I'm going to give this out another chance. Listen, I think you get it now. They were messy, but now they're mighty. Woo. See, I feel like sometimes we just too saved, right? Or we've been saved just too long, and maybe we just forgot who we used to be. that we used to be messy. Like, I can remember, I've been saved for 24 years, but I know who I used to be. And I know what God saved me from. And I know the mess that God pulled me out of and all the things that I wrestled with. And I can stand here today, and I'm on stage, and I'm preaching about Jesus. That's a miracle. He's taken me from messy to mighty. And now I'm planting a church. I'm excited. I'm excited about that. But God is reminding me through this passage that this is what he does. He takes us from messy to mighty, from caves to castles. It's what he does in all of Scripture. As you read through Scripture, he takes a wandering pagan, Abram, becomes the father of the faith. We have murderers and adulterers. They're God's chosen people to lead. And he takes a band of fishermen and tax collectors, and he makes them the apostles who will plant the very church that we now sit in to praise and worship God. Listen, this is what God does. That God doesn't take the qualified. That God takes the people that he's called. And he qualifies them from messy to mighty. This is why I get so excited about planting this church in Tinley Town. And I love all of the stories that people are bringing to me. And so I think I've lost the right to reserve any type of, I don't know the right way to say this, Pastor Tellis, but I'm just like, I don't have any reservations anymore about people joining my team. And maybe that's not the right thing to have, you know what I'm saying, as a leader. But I'm just like, man, the more messy you are, man, I feel like the more mightier you will become. And I just get excited about your story. Because I know that you have a story, and your story is meant to meet and match the person that God wants it to meet. There's something about you that God wants to do, to use, and to work through that I can't do. And I love the fact that you got a story. I love the fact that you have some pain. I love the fact that you've walked through some stuff and some trials and some caves. That just means God has more things for you to do and more people for you to reach, because that is what God is in the business of doing, taking us from messy to mighty, from caves to castle. This is what the church should be. This is what the church should be. As people come into the doors, when we look at them, we should see them as God sees them. We should see people the same way that God sees them, that their past is not a determiner of what they can do in the future. And even their present things that they're going through does not determine what God can do through a person. The only person who can determine that is God. And God says this, I am the resurrection and the life. I take people from graves to gardens, from death to life, from messy to mighty, from caves to castles. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that you are a God who redeems, who reconciles, and who restores. And you're a God who sees. And I thank you, God, that there isn't anything that we've been through in the past, or that we're going through in the present, or anything that someone said about us or did to us or anything of the sort that would keep us from your love, for one, and that would keep us from what you've called us to do. Thank you, God, that you are a God who looks at the unqualified, and you see purpose, and you see destiny, you see sons, you see daughters, you see your beloved. And I just pray for everyone here under the sound of my voice, especially if you've been lied to and told you that you would never amount to anything, or that there is really no purpose for you, or you don't know exactly what that is, and so you just kind of sit on the sidelines, and maybe you haven't been seen and you haven't been heard. I just wanted to pray today. I want you to hear this, that God sees you, that he's calling you by name, that everything that you've been through and walked through, that he's never left you nor forsaken you, that he's been there in the midst with you, and he is for you, and he wants to use that. He wants to use that testimony to not only change you, but to change those around you. I pray for everyone here today, especially those that are wrestling with their caves of darkness and despair and disillusionment and pain and darkness. That is not a place today where you run from God, but I believe God is using that to bring you exactly where you need to be, and that's here, and that's to meet him so that he can help you, and he can work some things in you. So I pray, Holy Spirit, work. Do your work today. Holy Spirit, move. Change hearts, change lives. Where there's brokenness, I pray, God, that you would restore and you would make whole. There's habitual sin habits. I pray for an empowering of your Holy Spirit tonight to overcome. Pray for those that are walking in fear. I pray right now, God, for your spirit of faith to come in this place. For those that are walking in depression, I pray for hope to fill them afresh. For those that have anxiety, I pray for peace. For those that are brokenhearted, I pray, God, that you would shower them with your love right now through your Holy Spirit. Before we land the plane, is there anyone here tonight who's hearing this message and you're in a different type of cave? You're in a cave of lost, and you don't know this King, this Jesus. And you're saying today, I'm here for a reason, and that's to meet him, and that's to know him. If that's you today, there is no day, no time like the present to say, hey, I want to get into that cave with the King. I want to know him. If that's you today, can you in faith lift your hand and say, hey, I want to know you. I want to know this Jesus. Well, God, I thank you for everyone here, and for those that may have already made that profession and confession and have turned their back to you a little bit, I pray today that they would make a decision to follow you and to say, hey, I want to follow you, Jesus. I want to know you. I want to grow. I want to mature. I want to be who you've called me to be. I want to step into the castle that you've prepared for me. I thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Family, I love you. God loves you more. And I pray that you have been helped tonight as much as I have been helped. That is it for tonight's service. If you need prayer tonight, we will have a team of prayer leaders down front that would love to pray with you, stand with you for anything that you're working or walking through. Other than that, you are free to go. Have a blessed night. Love you. See you Sunday.
It's not just a story. Yeah. I believe in the life of Jesus. I believe that he conquered death. I believe in the resurrection. I believe he's coming back again. I believe that his spirit's with us. I believe that he gives us power. I believe that he is the Son of God.
I'm praying, God, come and turn this thing around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. I'm calling on the name that changes everything, yes. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. All of my hope is in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough will come, come in the name of Jesus. I'm praying, God, come and turn this thing around. Turn it around, God, turn it around, God, turn it around. I'm calling on the name that changes everything.